Getting your first FPS controller in Godot is really easy, so follow along as we start with nothing and make a fully functional first-person controller here. We'll make a simple FPS camera, see important configuration options, see how moving platform works, then we'll add hands and even make some simple shooting with bullet holes for our character. Here's our starting scene. I just set up some lights and a few props to play with later. Let's start by creating our player. Add a new character body 3D, which we'll use to move the player. Then, we'll add a collision shape and create a new capsule collider. Let's move it up so it's above the ground and change the radius to 0.3 and the height 1.8. Let's also add a new mesh instance 3D in the same way as the collider, just so we can see it better. Next, we need to add a camera. Let's position it about the height of where the head should be. About here seems right. Now, let's make our player move. Create a new script and make sure the movement template is selected. This will get us started with some basic movement script. Now, let's name this FPS player and click create. We now have some basic movement script that can let us move around with the arrow keys and jump. But we can't move our camera yet, so let's make some changes. In the ready function, we set the mouse mode to mouse mode capture, so we can't see the mouse and it stays inside the screen. One way we can get the active camera is by using the getCamera 3D from the current viewport, but you can also pass it as an onReady variable if you prefer. To make the camera move, we are going to use the unhandle input function. If there is any mouse movement, we are going to rotate the player by the mouse X movement, and the camera's X axis by the mouse Y movement, rotating it up and down. You can adjust the rotation speed by multiplying these values here. Lastly, we are going to clamp the rotation axis of the camera, so we can't rotate past a certain angle while looking down or up too much. The values here are in radians, so this means we are limiting the camera's up-down rotation to about 80 degrees while looking down and 45 degrees while looking up. Now that we've got our basics, let's fix our keys. Open the Project Settings Input tab, and let's create the actions that we are going to use to control our player. Create a left, right, up, down, jump, click, quit, and toggle mouse actions. You can then click the plus button and set the keys for each action. WASD for the movement, space for the jump, and tab for the mouse toggle. Now let's change our script and use these actions. Replace the UI accept for jump and the UI left, right, up and down for hours. Next, we are going to add the mouse toggle so we can exit FPS mode and use the mouse for the menus. I also added a quick shortcut, so we can quickly close the game while testing. Here's how to do it. We create a mouse capture variable, then we check when the toggle mouse key is pressed. We toggle the mouse capture value and set the input mode to capture or visible. Very simple. Now we can press tab and show the mouse so we can use the menus, and press tab again to go back. Now, let's talk about moving platforms. But first, let's add some legs to our player so we can see where we are jumping. Let's rename our mesh inner body. Disable the scale link so we can scale it separately, and set the X scale to 0.5 and the Z scale to 0.5. I will also add a new material. This is just some blue tinted material. Next, select the camera and move it just a little bit forward. That way, when we look down, we are going to see our feet, which makes it much easier to see where we are stepping. Now, to create moving platforms in Godot is also very easy. This is done by using the animatable body in 3D. This is a special type of node that is able to transfer its speed to objects that are colliding with it. Let's add a mesh to our platform. Create a box 3D and change its size so it looks like a platform. I'm going to use 0.1 for the Y size and 1.5 for the others. And let's not forget to add a material. Here, I'm just using a green tinted material. With the mesh selected, you can use the mesh menu to quickly create a collision shape. Just make sure to select Simplified Convex to create a simple shape. Hit create, and we've got our collision node. Just as a note, Animatable Body 3D won't work with CSG collisions, so you need a real collision shape node here. To move our platform, we are going to use an animation player node. So let's create one now. With the animation panel open, click Animation and let's create a new animation, named Platform. Now we can start creating animation. Select the Animate Table Body and open the Transforms tab. If your animation tab is open, you'll see these key icons here. You can click on them to add a new keyframe. Go to the end of the timeline, move the platform, and press the key again to save the second position. And there you go, a simple animation. But there are some problems with this. If we move the platform and play the animation again, you'll see that it comes back to its key position. So if you want to move it a little bit to the side, you would need to create all the keyframes again, which is not ideal. So here's a better way to do animations for our platforms. Right-click the platform node and click Repair to a new node. Select a new node 3D and let's rename this Moving Platform. Select our animatable body and set its X and Z positions to 0. Put it back at the center of the world. Now, move the parent moving platform to the side and let's create our animation again. Select the animation player and then click on the animatable body node and let's recreate the animation like before. We can now use the moving platform node to quickly adjust the platform to any positions we want while keeping the animations intact, which is all good. But let's undo things and create a better animation. You can change our animation's time here. Let's change it to 4 seconds. Add a position keyframe, but this time, let's use the Use Bezier Curves option. This will split our positions into 3 values and allow us to precisely control how they move. Let's go to 1 second, move the platform, and add a new keyframe. Select all keyframes and Ctrl-C to copy them. Move to about 3 seconds and Ctrl-V to paste them. This will keep our platform stopped for a couple of seconds. You might need to copy them one at a time if copying them together is not working. Go to the end and duplicate the first keyframe, so we can have a loop. Now that we got our simple movement, let's make it more lively. Select this button here to open the Bezier's edit mode and show our curves. From here, you can select the blue Z movement curve and move the handles to adjust how fast or slow they move. Let's slightly change them and press play to see the results. You can continue to play around with this, but knowing how to use Bezier curves can be a very powerful tool in making animations. As a side note, if your curves are too close together, you can hold Ctrl and Alt together while scrolling the mouse wheel up and down to zoom in and out the values. And now we get a nice working moving platform. Now let's talk about some configuration options. The Character Body 3D is a very useful node, and it comes with a lot of options. Without changing anything, you are able to walk around slopes and jump. For slopes, you can change the maximum slope angle here. So after changing it, we now can't go up the red slope anymore. But make sure the max angle is always a bit higher than your actual slope angle. This green ramp here is 30 degrees, but it often starts and stops because of precision errors. So let's keep this value at 31 to fix this. Another important option here is snap length. When we go down a slope, the player's feet is always touching the ground. This here is used to decide if the ground is considered a slope or is just a fall. If we set this to 0 and try to walk down a slope, the player will just fall down and will not stay on the ground. So make sure to adjust our snap length properly. Another important option is constant speed. It tells whether the player will move faster or slower while moving up and down slopes. Stop on slope will stop sliding off slopes, but this won't change anything for us, as we don't add the gravity speed unless we are on floors. If we remove this line, we can now see the player slowly sliding down. And finally, we have the wall mean slide. This tells us when the player should slide off walls. Right now, if we press forward on a wall, the player will slide off it and continue moving. But if we change this to a higher angle, the player won't slide off anymore, until it crosses that value. So if you want the player movement to stop on walls, you can set this value to 90, and it won't slide off anymore. Now that we got our basics down, let's add some hands to our player. I'm going to use this simple hand model from itch.io that comes with a weapon and a few animations. You can get the link from the description. The downloaded arms are a simple FBX file, Let's make sure to have our idle animation to loop by setting its loop mode to linear. And this model comes with a camera, so make sure to select Skip on Import, hit Reimport, and let's start. Dragging our arms to the scene and put them inside our player. And let's put them in position and rotate them the right way. But we need a better way to see if they are in the right position. So select the arms and enable editable children so we can see inside our model. Select the arms animation player and set the animation to pistol idle. And click on this icon to set the animation to autoplay on load. Now we only need a way to see what our camera is seeing. Select the camera, open the view menu and enable a second viewport. On the viewport below, activate the camera preview. Now we can see our camera's view. The yellow lines represent the game's Windows border. Now select the arms and move them into position until you get something you like. Just don't forget to put the arms inside the camera so it will rotate together with the view. Here are the final values I ended up using. I chose to have only the hands visible in the end, but now that our player has hands, we also have some new problems. It's a very common problem with FPS games: weapon clipping. There are a couple of ways to solve this, each with their pros and cons. One way is to use subviewports. You make your arms to be drawn in a separate viewport and draw them on top of everything. But this method has a problem with shadows. Our arms doesn't receive shadows from the walls, not to mention the performance cost of adding a new viewport and scaling issues. So although this might sound a bit more complicated, the better solution is shaders. A very simple one. To fix the clipping, we'll need to change our built-in materials. So let's select our arm mesh, open the mesh, surface, and we would need to change this material, but we can't change the properties here, as this is an imported material. So we need to copy this material and paste it inside the override material. Doing this, we'll create a new copy and let us change it. Use the material dropbox menu and select Convert to Shader Material. This will create a shader material based off of the changed properties of the default material. This will also keep the textures of our material. Select the material and click the shader to open it. And we get a bunch of pre-generated shader code. But you don't need to worry about it. Let's make sure to save it so we can reuse it later. Save it as FPS View Model. To fix our clipping problem, we are going to need to add a couple of lines. At the end of the fragment shader, this depth line at the end will scale our depth value so our model is rendered on top of things. And at the top of the file, we have these three lines inside the vertex shader in a new FOV uniform. This will make our arms have an independent FOV from the camera and also fix some light issues that are caused by changing the depth buffer. If you are wondering why you don't just disable the depth test to always render the mesh, here's the reason. We need to have the depth test so complex meshes don't render on top of themselves. If we test our game now, you can see our hands are no longer clipping through walls. But we still need to do the same to the other parts of the weapon. Repeating this to all the meshes can be very slow, so here's the fastest way I found to do it. Copy the material, paste it, convert to shader material, and drag in our saved shader. Because the shader's parameters are the same, Godot is smart enough to keep our values, our textures. If you just drag in the shader to the material, it will create a new shader material with its own default values. So now we just need to repeat this for every other material you have. If you have many models, you could also use an import script to automate this process. Here's a quick video on how to use them. Now our weapons don't clip anymore. Everything is good. Or not. Now our shadows are gone. The reason for that is this. After we changed our projection matrix, our shadows are now distorted and somewhere else in the world. There doesn't seem to be a way to fix this in Godot yet, but we can fix our shadows in another way. First, let's select our meshes and disable cache shadows. Next, we are going to duplicate our arms. And you might see where this is going. Rename it Shadows, select all the meshes, and set them to Shadows only. And now we got broken shadows and no clipping issues. Now, what's an FPS without shooting? Let's take care of that. First, let's add a naming dot, create a new canvas layer, and add a color rect inside. Set the color to black, and set the size to 5.5. then change the anchor preset to center. Done! We now have a little dot on the screen. But this is very important, don't forget to set your mouse filter to ignore. If you don't do this, it will prevent click events to get to our player controller. One very easy way to make an FPS shoot is to use a raycast. So let's add one to our camera. Set the target position to 0, 0, -15. This will be our range. Let's also disable our raycast. We don't need to check for collisions every frame, so we are going to disable it and control it by code. Let's rename the raycast to weapon raycast and create a new script for it. Here, we are going to need a reference to our arms animation player. And if you use the shadows, the animation of that too, so they are in sync. Then we use the input function to check for our click action and make the shot happen. We stop the current animation and play the pistol fire. The reason we stop it first is so the animation restarts if the start shooting animation is still playing. Then we call force raycast update to manually execute the raycast, which will update the nodes variables. If we collide with something, and that something is a rigid body 3D, we add some force to push that object away. You can get the hit position with the getCollisionPoint function and use the -globalBasis.z to get the direction the raycast is pointing at. And with that, we got our weapon done. Shadows working, and we can even hit some rigid bodies for target practice. But something is still missing, and that is bullet holes. Adding them is also fairly easy. Godot has this decal node. It projects the texture down into meshes, and it is very easy to use. Dragging a bullet hole texture. This is just a random shape I created in Inkscape, but you can use a proper bullet hole texture yourself. You can also set its normal, emission, and ORM texture, which is a combined texture of occlusion, roughness, and metallic textures mapped together. Now, let's adjust our decal. You can hold Alt to scale the gizmo square on both sizes at the same time. And to make your decals always 100% visible, open the vertical fade tab and set the upper and lower fade to the max, so it will always render at full opacity. Next, let's make sure our decals only barely goes off the floor. And scale it down to a nice size. You can also adjust the values here. I ended up using 0.25 in both X and Z values. If you have problems seeing the hole, you can disable gizmos from the perspective menu. Just don't forget to enable them back later. Now right-click the decal and save it to a scene. And let's name it Bullet Decal. Open the scene and make sure the decal is at the center. Open the Transform tab, reset the position, and save it. Back to our main scene, we can delete the decal there. And now, let's open our weapon raycast again and make some changes. Dragging our bullet decal scene and press Ctrl before releasing it to create a preload variable. And let's create a bullet decal function to spawn our bullet holes. Now, when our raycast hits something, if that something is a static body or a CSG shape, we spawn a bullet hole. You can get the raycast hit normal by calling the getCollisionNormal function. Inside the decal function, we first instantiate the decal node and add it to the scene. Next, we rotate it towards the hit normal, and then rotate it again in the x-axis by 90 degrees. The reason for that is that the decal projects its textures downwards, but the lookAt function uses the -z axis to turn the object. After that, we can rotate the decal into the normal direction to make the sprite rotate, just to give some variation. And then we can use the await keyword to create a new timer and wait 1.5 seconds before destroying the bullet hole. And there you go! Bullet holes working everywhere. We can still improve our decals by making them slowly fade away. To do that, we create a new twin and use the twin property to animate the modulate alpha and change its alpha value to 0 in 1.5 seconds. Then we add another timer just so our twin can finish animating before destroying the hole. And now our bullet holes will slowly fade away. And as a final touch, I added a simple particle effect for when the bullet hits the walls. It uses a simple rectangle mesh and has a one-shot timer with high explosiveness. And for the processed material, I just changed the initial velocity. The particle node itself just has a simple script to enable it. Now, shooting things creates sparks. And that's it. A very basic FPS controller that can get you started. I hope you liked this video, and until next time.